St. Paul, and welcome to our family and friends who are worshiping with us this morning. To our guests who are with us, we know you have plenty of online choices for worshiping, so your presence with us speaks volume, and we're glad you're here. To our St. Paul family, thanks for continuing to support St. Paul Online, our digital worship experience with your presence. There's a popular song with the lyrics, "What the world needs now is a love, sweet love." You know the song. And with so much discourse and hate, we can all agree that the world does need more love. The sermon series to kick off 2021, All In, Soul, Mind, and Strength, is all about our command to love God and what it means to love others as ourselves. I hope you commit to take this all-in journey of love with us each Sunday as our digital worship experience seeks to connect you closer with God. Remember to like and share this worship experience right now. I will see you in the comments.
Good morning, St. Paul, and a special hello to our guests and friends. Here's news and information you can use for this week that can help you get connected and grow right here at St. Paul.
Midday Manna Bible Study is back, St. Paul. You don't want to miss out on this hour of inspiration with Pastor Marcus Harris. Log on to Zoom each Wednesday at 12:15 and be rejuvenated. That's right, each Wednesday at 12:15 p.m. Don't forget to invite a friend to join in for this dynamic time of teaching God's Word. Ladies, join us each Sunday morning at 9:15 a.m. as we commit to the 28-day prayer journey. This study is for anyone longing for a consistent prayer life. Don't come alone. Share your Zoom information with a friend or a family member. The men are studying calling in the New Testament. Please join in every Sunday morning for a dynamic time of studying God's Word. That's Sundays at 9:15 a.m. on Zoom. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "Life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others?" Well, St. Paul, we have an opportunity to respond Monday to serve with the Meals on Wheels organization. They are still looking for volunteers to deliver food. This is a socially distanced way to serve those in our community who will go without food to eat without these deliveries. To sign up and serve, visit volunteer.vnatexas.org. Did you know a single pint of blood can save three lives? Be a part of saving lives and support the United Methodist Women's Blood Drive with the American Red Cross. Blood donations are accepted Tuesday, January the 19th from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. at the AT&T Performing Arts Center. That's at 2403 Flora Street. No registration is required. Just plan now to drop in and donate blood and save a life.
To learn more about the happenings of St. Paul, please visit our website at www.spumcd.com. Thank you for your attention and have a blessed week.
Thank you. Friends, it is now time to worship the Lord in the giving of our gifts. God is so generous and so good to us, and we respond to God's love in the way we give. Would you go to spumcd.com and give as the Lord leads you? God bless you.
We've got to give ourselves to this struggle until the end. Nothing would be more tragic than to stop at this point in Memphis. I want to thank God once more for allowing me to be here with you. I left Atlanta this morning and then I got into Memphis. And some began to say the threats. I talk about the threats that were out. What would happen to me from some of our sick white brothers? Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
We've got to give ourselves to this struggle until the end. Nothing would be more tragic than to stop in Memphis. These prophetic words from Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King are so prevalent, spoken to motivate those in the fight for civil rights for all people in the 1960s. These powerful words still ring true for us today. The struggle still continues. And because we are the people of God called by God's name, nothing would be more tragic than for us to stop by turning a blind eye to the issues that are going on in our nation and in our nation's capital today. Nothing would be more tragic than for us to stop by ignoring the injustice of racism and bigotry and pure hatred. Church, nothing would be more tragic than for us to stop by not being advocates of God's holy word as we're called to be, speaking truth to power in love and mercy and grace. Dr. King says, we've got to give ourselves to this struggle until the end. Tomorrow, we celebrate Martin Luther King Day. How will you give of yourself?
Brought me out, Lord. Lord, I remember how you made a way. Lord, I remember. Turn darkness into day. Lord, I remember how you set me free. Lord, I remember. You delivered me. Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Jesus. 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 I can't forget. I won't forget. I can't forget. Lord, I remember how you set me free. Lord, I remember you delivered me. Lord, I remember how you made a way. Lord, I remember. Turn darkness into day. Lord, I remember how you set me free. Lord, I remember you delivered me. Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Jesus. 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 Lord, Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Jesus. 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 Lord, I thank you. 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 I thank you, Jesus. I care for.
Let us pray. Lord, we come today saying thank you. Thank you for all your many blessings. Thank you for covering us and keeping us. God, we realize that you are our creator, and beside you there is no other. Lord, we ask right now that you be with us in the midst of whatever is going on around us, in our families, in our workplaces, in our country. Lord, we ask that you be in all those situations. that you help us to keep peace, help us to be the peacemakers. Lord, we ask right now that you be with our congregation, those that have called you God. Lord, we ask that you grant us those things that we stand in need of, Lord, and we ask for forgiveness for those things that we have done and said that were displeasing to you. God, we need your forgiveness. Lord, we come to you today as the word goes forth. Lord, let it touch our hearts and our minds. Go into those deep places that no one knows about but you, that it may touch us and change us and renew us. Lord, we thank you again for our pastor, for her leadership, and for the things that she is doing to keep us on track and keep us reminded that you are our God. So we thank you and praise you for all that you have done. We thank you for those things that you are doing that we don't know about yet, those things to help us, to renew us, to bring us into a better place. And God, we look forward to the fruit of those things that you have sown in us. It's in Christ's name that we ask all things. Amen.
Good morning, St. Paul family and friends. Join us today as we come to you with God's word from Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 through 26. Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life?" So let us know today that this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sins. How can a song describe him? Where shall my praise begin? Taking away my burdens, setting my spirit free. The wonderful grace of Jesus always reaches me.
Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sins. How can a song describe him? Where shall my praise begin? Taking away my burdens, setting my spirit free. Wonderful grace of Jesus, it always reaches me. It's beautiful, wonderful, powerful. All the grace that found me. It's beautiful, wonderful, powerful. All the grace that found me.
Wonderful grace of Jesus, deep as a rolling sea. It runs to the most forgotten, it runs through eternity. It says I'm a child of heaven, it says I'm forever free. The wonderful grace of Jesus says I'm a child of heaven. Says I'm forever free.
The wonderful grace of Jesus.
Friends, let's pray and see what the Lord would speak to our hearts this Sunday morning. Gracious and loving God, we thank you. God, we continue to cry out and call upon you. These are difficult and troubling and chaotic days, but you are the God who brings order to chaos. You are the God who brings light and truth. You are the God who sustains and maintains us. And so, God, you are the God we are trusting. You're the God we are believing. You are the God we are relying on. God, strengthen us this day for your work. Strengthen us this day, God, to be your people. Strengthen us this day through your word, because your word is truth. We give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, today we are continuing in our sermon series, All In, Loving God with Heart, Soul, Mind, and Strength. You know, Jesus said that the command to love God with the heart, mind, soul, and strength was the most important of all the commandments. And last week we talked about that first part, what it means to love God with all of our hearts, all of our passions and emotions and affections. And that we must surrender our hearts to God so that God can do a work in our hearts. God can search us and enable and empower us to love God and to love one another. And in days like these, friends, we need to be empowered. We need to understand what it means to truly love God and live powerfully out of that love for God and that love for one another. Today's subject is the second part of that verse that we looked at last week, loving God with all my soul. What does it mean to love the Lord with all of our soul? We're going to talk some about that today because, you know, the word soul is used in so many ways and it has several different meanings. People often talk about finding their soulmate as that person that is just right for them, that person that completes you, right? That person made for you, finding the one, your soulmate. So we mean one thing when we're talking about soul in that context. You know, Aretha Franklin was known as the queen of soul, wasn't she? That's right. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. The moment I wake up, before I put on my makeup. Amen, somebody. And, you know, soul music incorporated elements of rhythm and blues and gospel made popular in African-American culture, music that embodies deep feeling and deep emotion. It means something to say that you have soul. That's one way to talk about that word. You know, Disney right now has a movie out entitled Soul. And in this story, I'm sorry if I spoil this for you today, but this story is about a middle school teacher whose name is Joe Gardner. And he's on this journey to reunite his soul and his body after they are accidentally separated just before he gets his big break as a musician. And so here, the soul is seen as another way. It's a living entity distinct from the physical being. The soul is a part of the body, but it's separate from the body. It is that which animates or enlivens the physical body. So what do we mean exactly then when we talk about loving God with all of our soul? Soul is defined as the spiritual or immaterial part of a human being. When the Bible talks about the soul, it is talking about a living, breathing, conscious body. The soul is regarded as distinct, as I said, from the body or physical part of a human being. And the essence of the biblical definition of soul means life. The soul is that part that defines the essence of who we are. It is in our body, but it is different from our body. The Hebrew word for soul is nephesh, and nephesh refers to a living, breathing, conscious body. This is the word that is used in Genesis 2, verse 7, that says, "Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being," or some texts say a living soul. God breathed life into us. God breathed into human beings, and we became living beings. We have within us the breath, the very life of God. And so soul here deals with consciousness. In the Hebrew context, people don't have a nephesh, they are a nephesh. It describes the whole human being as a living and physical organism. Now, friends, the Greek word for soul is psyche, and psyche means soul, mind, and spirit, the invisible animating entity which occupies our physical body. And you'll often see in scripture the words soul and spirit are used interchangeably. The soul is the life that was given to us by our Creator. It is our very essence. And while it has something to do with the body, the feelings, and the mind, it is in essence beyond all of this. It is your person, created and enlivened by God. And friends, that's why when someone dies, the body remains, but we understand that the person, the soul, the spirit is gone. It is no longer here. They are no longer present. That's what Paul meant when he said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. In other words, the body may still remain, but the soul, the spirit has now returned to God, its creator. So loving God with the soul is loving God from the very essence of our being, from the very essence of our life. And so we are to love God with all of our life. You know, I talked about last week the fact that it sounds like loving God is a tall order, and it is, but it is what the Lord requires of us. Our entire being is to display and show off the fact that we love God. We love the Lord with all our soul, friends, and one way I believe is by living a life of faithfulness to what the Lord has required of us. Mm-hmm. The Bible often talks about what the Lord requires. The words in Micah, I think, are relevant for us today. What does the Lord require of us? But to do justice and to love mercy and to walk humbly with God. We love God with our soul when we live the way God has called us to live. And this is basically what Jesus is saying to the disciples in Matthew 16, verses 24 through 26, when he tells his disciples, if you want to be my followers, you must deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. If you want to save your life, you have to lose it. If you want to hang on to your life, you've got to give it away. For what, he says, will it profit anyone if I gain the whole world, but forfeit my life or forfeit my soul or forfeit your soul? You see, if we are followers of Jesus, friends, our lives are not ours. You don't belong to yourself, and I don't belong to myself. We are not free agents. You know, it's interesting to me how unpopular Christian teaching is with Christian people. Amen, somebody. Sometimes, though we call ourselves Christians, we don't necessarily want to live the Christian life. Joe Gardner, who's the main character in Soul, discovered that he had not really been living. He was so consumed by his pursuit, so consumed by his career, so consumed chasing after his dream that he missed his very life. We lose out on living, friends. We lose out on living lives that matter when we fail to understand that as those who call ourselves believers in Jesus Christ, we are to give our lives away. I wonder what the world today would look like if more people who call themselves Christians would give our lives away. I wonder how things would be today if instead of being so consumed with everything else, we were consumed with giving our lives away. We love that song, I give myself away so you can use me. Are we truly giving ourselves away? Because I'm telling you, we serve an all-in kind of God. We serve a God who is calling us to be all in. We serve a God who's not going to settle for 20%. We serve a God who's calling us to be all in, to 100%, to keep it 100. Amen, somebody. God desires and deserves nothing less than all we have to offer and all we have to give. You know, Jesus tells the scribe in Mark 12, we had to love God with heart, mind, soul, and strength. And this is the most important commandment, because by this time there were 613 laws. And the scribe was like, listen, I don't have time for all 613. Tell me what the bottom line is. Tell me what's most important. Tell me what I truly need to follow. And I love that Jesus redirects this scribes' focus away from the law of God and focuses him on the God of the law. He takes him away from looking at all the rules and regulations and focuses his attention on who God is. And friends, I believe that Jesus wants us to take a closer look at who God is so that in God we might discover real life. In God we might discover what it means to live and to have joy and to be faithful and to experience God's best for us. You know, people give their lives to so many things. You know, Jesus was telling Martha when she was consumed with busyness. He says, Martha, you're too busy. One thing matters. And he points to Mary and says, she has chosen the better part. She has chosen to sit at my feet and be blessed. She's chosen to sit and to listen and to learn of me. Mm-hmm. She has chosen to nurture her soul. I wonder, friends, how much time do we spend nurturing our souls? Do we really know what it means to nurture the soul that God has given us to nurture and develop our inner life so that our inner life is directing our outer life. Amen, somebody. Our inner life that comes from God, that is rooted in God and must be nurtured by God is the life that should be directing our outer life. So how do we love the Lord with all of our soul? We need to know because it is one of the four things Jesus said we need to do to love God completely. I want you to know this morning, I don't have an exhaustive answer, but I do believe that loving God with a soul means a few things. It means, first of all, that we desire and we pursue intimacy with God. You see, intimacy is about deep connection. When a person talks about their soulmate, they're talking about someone who they feel a deep connection to, a deep personal connection with, someone that they feel close to that they cannot imagine living without. To love God with all of our soul is to love God with our very life. It is to have a deep connection with God, to desire to be close to God. It requires intimacy. And one of the things that it means is worship. We worship God with heart. We worship God with soul. It is one of the ways we demonstrate our love for God. And it is so important in times like these that we continue to worship. It is so important when we are stressed and worried and anxious that we continue to worship because it is one of the ways we develop intimacy with God. It is one of the ways we draw close to the Lord. We hear this in Psalm 103, verse 1 that says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God, I bless you. I worship you with everything that is within me. I know we miss being together. I know we miss worshiping together because there are wonderful things that happen when we worship together. But friends, you can worship in your living room. Amen, somebody. You can worship in your shower. You can worship while you're driving down the street. Your soul can connect with God. You see, our worship is an exclamation of gratitude and admiration for the Lord that comes from the very depths of our soul. Everything about us, everything within us, all that we are, all that God has made us declares God's greatness. To be intimate with God is to worship God. Intimacy also involves spending time in God's presence and in God's word. And friends, that means we have to intentionally carve out time in our day to talk to the Lord. Because when you love somebody, you talk to them. Amen, somebody. If you're not talking to your spouse, you're not gonna have a spouse. Amen, somebody. Intimacy requires conversation and connection. It requires speaking and listening. And we must daily cultivate a closer relationship with the one who breathed life into us. You see, if God breathed that life into us, we need God to sustain that life within us. We need God to keep giving life to us. And God knows how to sustain us. God knows how to keep us. God knows how to strengthen us. God knows how to keep breathing life into us. God knows what we need. Intimacy with the Lord gives us life. Romans 8:11 says, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. Friends, loving God with the soul means we are intimate with God and we worship God and we allow God's spirit to nurture our souls. And then, friends, it also means that we love the Lord in the way we live, in our choices, and in the decisions that we make. Loving God with our soul means we love God in the way we live. We have our own ideas and our own plans for our lives, and I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't. But the question I have is, do we allow God to have first place, to interrupt our agenda, to change our plans, or to lead us in a different direction? Proverbs 19:21 says, the human mind may devise many plans, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will be established. He says, we might make plans all day long, but it is what God's purpose that will be established in our lives. The New Living Translation says it this way, you can make many plans, but the Lord's purpose will prevail. Mm-hmm. It is what God desires and designs that will be established, that will take root, that will prosper, that will work, that will be beneficial, that will bless, that will help, that will heal, that will deliver, and that will save. Because it is God's purposes that are life-giving. God's purpose satisfies the longing of our souls. You know, we are often in pursuit of things that do not satisfy, things that do not give us life, things that the world tells us we must pursue. You know, Joe Gardner in Soul discovered that what he had been pursuing his whole life, when he finally got it, it did not nurture or feed his soul, and he wondered what in the world he had been pursuing all of his life, because the soul needs more. The soul longs for more because the soul comes from God and it longs for the things of God. You know, God breathed life into us and there's this space in us that was designed for God, that only the things of God can fill. And some of us spend our lifetimes chasing and pursuing things that will never satisfy. The psalmist said in Psalm 63, verse 1, oh God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you. He says, God, I got to have you. I don't know what I'm going to do if I can't have more of you. We try to fill that longing with many other things, accomplishments, money, status, the approval of people, possessions, things that our culture deems are important. But friends, it is pursuing God's purpose and God's plan that gives life to our soul. It matters that we spend our energy, the essence of our life, that our soul's passion and pursuit is what God desires for us. We love God by pursuing God's way, God's will, and God's purpose. Well, I hear this morning, well, preacher, how do I know what God's purpose is? We have to go deeper. Mm-hmm. As those who love God, who are in relationship with God, we have to go deeper as disciples, as followers of Jesus. That brings me to Jesus' words in Mark 16, where it says, if anyone wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. You won't hear anybody doing flips and cheering about that. If you want to follow me, if you want to go deeper, Jesus said, if you want to be serious about this thing, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and come after me. Can I ask you a question that I'm also asking myself? What risk have you taken for the Lord? Mm-hmm. What have you denied yourself in order to more fully follow Jesus Christ? When has the Lord interrupted your agenda, changed your direction, messed with your plans, rearranged your priorities? What Jesus offers the disciples and us is an invitation to follow him more closely, for a closer walk with thee, as the song says, for a closer relationship with God. Psalm 63:8 says, my soul follows close behind you. Your right hand upholds me. Or as the New Living Translation says, I cling to you. God, I'm clinging to you. I'm holding on to you with all that I've got. Have you ever seen a young child cling to his mother? They are not letting go. You cannot pry that baby off his mama's leg or out of his mama's arms. That's what it means. God says, I want you to cling to me. I want you to hang on to me. I want you to hang on to my every word. I want you to follow me more closely. Loving God with our soul means honoring God, clinging to God, following God's will. It means we must go deeper. We must go farther. We must begin to follow him more closely. We must be able to deny ourselves. He says, pick up the cross. Follow the way that I have gone. And the way of the cross, friends, is not always an easy way. The way of the cross, friends, is a way sometimes of sacrifice. The way of the cross means we're going to go through some things in order to follow him. Loving God with our soul means we must go deeper. In this passage in Matthew 16, Jesus has asked the disciples a specific question. He asked them, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And the disciples give him different answers until Peter boldly declares, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Peter's declaration reveals his faith. You see, disciples of Christ believe that in Jesus, something new has happened. That in Jesus, new life has occurred. In Jesus, God has acted and moved. That God now has come up close and personal to us. That God has changed everything. We can't call ourselves Christian and nothing changes in our lives. Because God has done a dramatic and a miraculous work in Jesus Christ. And now that same Jesus is alive in us. And because he lives in us, he changes us. We have a relationship with the God who created all things. God in Christ has loved us beyond measure, beyond what we can understand, beyond what we can grasp. And this love calls us to go deeper. This love calls us to live differently. This love calls us to speak truth today, to speak truth to power. This love calls us to stand strong against the forces of evil. This love calls us to stand up and speak out and make a difference in this world. And that means it's going to cause us some discomfort. It's going to cause us some good trouble. It's going to cost us to follow Jesus. If we're going to fully follow Christ and love the Lord with all of our soul, if we're going to be all in, we got to take some risk. We got to risk being who we say we are. We have to risk being the people of God who will not tolerate evil, who will not tolerate injustice, who will not believe the lie, but will believe the truth. We risk being countercultural. We risk looking different. We risk rejection and being misunderstood. If you love your life, Jesus says, good, then you got to be willing to lose it. You got to be willing to let it go. If you try to hang on to your life, if you try to hang on to doing it your way, he says you're going to lose the blessings of really living. Mm-hmm. What he's saying here is we've got to love following God's ways more than doing our own thing. You got to love God more than you love doing you. Amen, somebody. Mm-hmm. And in that, he says, you will find real life. To deny ourselves, to live a life of self-denial is not subservient. It's not spineless. It is to fearlessly follow the Lord no matter what it costs. Loving God with our soul, friends, means living a God-centered life. That's when the direction of our lives is wrapped up, tied up, tangled up, as the song says in Jesus. You say, well, that's too much. That's too radical. Yes, it is. And that's what loving God with our soul means. That Christ is our greatest treasure. That we prize nothing above that relationship. And it's not just talk. It is our daily reality. It is our daily practice. Do your friends know that you love Jesus? Do people in your life know that you are on fire for the Lord? Do they know that you have centered your life around the one who gave his life for you, or is he a well-kept secret in your life? Amen, somebody. If we love God with our soul, it's going to be obvious. People are going to know that you're a Jesus freak. Amen, somebody. People are going to know that you are passionate about the things of God. Because in that, the Bible declares, is where we find real life. We take up our cross daily. Daily, we lose our lives. Daily, we give ourselves away. And we find real meaning and real hope and real peace and real joy in Jesus. And so Jesus asks, what's it gonna profit someone to gain the whole world and lose their life? It's a rhetorical question. It means it's asked for emphasis. What good will it do to gain everything but lose your soul, to lose what truly matters? Do you know when everything changed for Joe Gardner? It was the moment he was willing to let go of his life so someone else could live. He was willing to let his life go so that someone else could have life. The minute he gave his life away, he found real life. And he got another chance to truly live. You know, friends, there's only one goal that is always worth striving for every day of our lives. There's only one who is worthy of all of our attention and devotion and honor and praise and worship and surrender. He is Christ the Lord, and he is worthy. He is worthy of all of our love. He is worthy of our all. And so today, all I want to encourage us to do is to love him, to love the Lord with all our soul. Will you love the Lord today from the very essence of your being, the very essence of your soul? Because he's worthy, because he offers us in return real life. Let us pray. God of grace, God of glory, God of power, God of might, you who have breathed life into your children, breathe afresh and anew on us again. Remind us of who we are. Remind us that our lives are to be centered around you, that in you we live and move and have our being. That when we lose our life, we find real life because it is the life that you have given us. God, reorient us today. Wrap us all around you today. Fill us with your love. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe you don't know what it means to love God with your soul because you're not in a relationship. You're out of connection. You're just kind of out there on your own. Well, we want to invite you to come and to come to know who Jesus is, the one who has given his life for you, who loves you right here, right now. Or maybe you do know the Lord, but you are disconnected from the body of Christ. You don't have a church. You don't know what it means to be a part of the family of faith. We would love to have you connect with us. We would love to share the love of Christ with you. We would love for that loving God with all of our heart and soul to spill over in our love for you. Would you email me, please, at lfaison@spumcd.net. I would love to talk with you about Jesus. I would love to pray with you. I would love to help you get connected. God bless you, and we'll see you next week in our virtual worship experience.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. Remember, we are sending you love and virtual hugs, and we will see you next week.